Welcome to the Ray Harryhausen podcast, the show dedicated to the life, career, and films of a special effects titan. Join us as we host in-depth discussions about the work, influences, and legacy of this uniquely talented filmmaker. Brought to you by the Ray and Diana Harryhausen Foundation, we will be delving into Ray's archive to bring a unique insight into his work, including exclusive audio from the man himself from our own archives. We will be joined by special guests for retrospectives, exclusive announcements and competitions, so this podcast is a must-listen for all fans of the world of Ray Harryhausen, animation and classic filmmaking.
Hello and welcome to episode 16 of the Ray Harryhausen podcast. We're making a departure from our normal podcast and looking particularly at the music of Ray Harryhausen films. Now, that's such a vast subject, we're going to spread it across three podcasts. And initially, we're going to start in chronology with Ray's early work from the 1940s right up to the late 1950s. And we're going to have some excerpts of music, and we're going to have hopefully some audio from Ray Harryhausen himself. And we're going to talk a bit about the unsung heroes of film composition, because of those of you who know Bernard Herrmann and Miklos Rocher and later composers like Laurie Johnson, you might not be as familiar with some of those people who were pretty much sort of backroom boys for film composition in this era. And I'm joined again by collections manager Connor Heaney. Hello, Connor.
Hello, John. It's good to be here. This is something we've been wanting to do for a little while now, exploring the music of Ray Harryhausen's films. It's something that's so important and something that really jumps out to people is what great composers Ray got to work with throughout the years. And we're hoping to uncover a few hidden gems as well along the way. So starting with Ray's early black and white pictures, it's going to be a really interesting exploration, delving into those early soundtracks and those early scores.
Absolutely. So we're going to kick off. What have we got first, Connor? We've got Mighty Joe Young. What's the track we're going to be listening to?
Well, the first track we're going to listen to here is Joe and the Lion from Mighty Joe Young. And this is part of Joe's introductory scene in the film. So memorable when Joe is beating on the lion's cage, the lion snarling at him. Such a wonderful piece of animation by Ray. It's well known that although the film was a Willis O'Brien animation production, Ray probably did around 90% of the actual animation of the Joe model. This scene is one of the classic scenes of the film. Just goes to show how much character and how much emotion that Ray could invest into this lovable gorilla creature. And so Joe and the Lion is one of many action sequences in the film. When you watch the film again, I watched it again just yesterday to refresh my memory. There's so many action sequences in the film. There's a lot going on, and the music obviously matches that with high intensity. And so the themes that you'll hear in this track are repeated throughout the film during the nightclub sequence and later sequences too. John, what are your thoughts about the Mighty Joe Young score?
It's extravagant. You know, it's a very large orchestra. It's a very complex score. And it's, to be pejorative about it, there's a lot of Mickey Mousing going on. And that means if you look at Mickey Mouse cartoons, the music is almost a sound effect. So when Joe is hitting the lion and he's pounding the floor, the music, bom, 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 follows along. And that's called Mickey Mousing. So in early Silly Symphonies, Mickey Mouse cartoons for Walt Disney, the music would very much help the animation walk along and have a certain pace. And this was sort of falling out of favour at the time. So RKO and Mighty Joe Young at the time were considered to be extravagant, rather overblown. The music, which I think is charming and works very well with the film, is very much in a time capsule. And Ray came to Mighty Joe Young when this sort of Mickey Mousing was falling out of favour. I suppose if we have a listen now to Joe and the Lion, we'll get a sense of what we're talking about. I love Mighty Joe and I love the music by Roy Webb. And more about Roy in a moment. Let's have a listen.
Thank you.
Roy Webb, not a household name, but a composer who lived for a very long time and worked on many films, and was born in 1888 and died in 1982. So lived until he was about 94, and worked predominantly with RKO Pictures on pretty much everything that that came his way. Now, this is the interesting thing and the departure from what we recognise as people like Jerry Goldsmith and Bernard Herrmann and Michael Giacchino now, who's doing all those wonderful J.J. Abrams films. The studio would give you the composer who was available and sometimes give you the music that had previously been recorded. So it wasn't a case of Ray Harryhausen, if he had a choice on this picture, choosing a composer. He was very much working, as was Willis O'Brien, with the composers who were available. Years ago at the BBC, if you were making a television programme, if you were a director, you'd find out week to week which show you were working on, whether it was Zed Cars or Doctor Who and so on. The landscape for film and television has changed vastly. Production companies are set up for individual films or individual television programmes. And that's a good thing because it gives a different sense of style and there isn't that sense of pedestrian production. But it also means that people are constantly fighting for the next project. In the studio system, the people behind the scenes weren't well known. Ray Harryhausen, for example, didn't become well known until much later on. And these people who are the workhorses, if we can call them that, of film music, would have no real choice in what they did. And often wouldn't have much choice in how they did it. So things would be very defined. And I think within those tight parameters, Roy Webb is one of the best exponents of that music. Unfortunately, many of the recordings don't exist anymore. And we'll go into that a little bit later on, the technical aspect of it. But it's a great one to open with, a powerful one to open with. And I think for Ray Harryhausen himself, Connor, it was the very best launch pad in terms of a film to work on. Mighty Joe Young, a very expensive studio picture.
Yes, that's something that's worth remembering, is that as Ray's first movie, the first project he worked on, and you know, a dream come true in itself because he got to work with his hero and mentor, Willis O'Brien. But Ray as first technician on such a large film, what an ostentatious start to a career. It was a big budget affair, it was a big success, and it received an Academy Award for Best Special Effects. And this may be something that people looking back at Ray's films now might not appreciate as much. They maybe think of Ray's black and white films as being lower budget affairs, but Mighty Joe Young was a big film with a big orchestra and lots of major players involved, produced by John Ford and Marion C. Cooper. So many callbacks to a film from 15 years earlier, King Kong, which everybody knows was Ray's favourite film. And I think the score to Mighty Joe Young is quite reminiscing of Max Steiner's work on King Kong. It's the same kind of bombastic and larger-than-life feeling.
Absolutely. You know, Cooper originally wanted Max Steiner to score Mighty Joe, but he couldn't get, say, a release from his Warner Brothers contract. So I think that's why Webb kind of stuck to a, as you say, bombastic King Kong feel, because the template had very much been set. You know, Max Steiner and his work for 1933's King Kong is very much a landmark in film music and one that all of the composers today recognise. So it's a great one for us to open with.
It's incredible when you look at the Internet Movie Database for just how many films and television shows that some of these composers worked on. I think Roy Webb is credited with over 300 films. And so this particular piece has a lot of themes that are reminiscent of Max Steiner. So this is an interesting one in that it seemed to fit together quite nicely. Roy Webb's particular skill set and the large bombastic production that Mighty Joe Young required.
Now, in contrast to that, a much lower budget, a much faster shoot, a much more contained story, The Beast from 20,000 Fathoms, based on Ray Bradbury's short story that was published in the Washington Post, was to be Ray Harryhausen's next project. And David Buttolph was the composer there. And he again lived to a grand age of 80. And you've got, Connor, a clip to play from Beast and 20,000 Fathoms, haven't you?
That's right. This is the iconic scene of the film, or one of the most iconic scenes from the film anyway, the scene where the Beast, the Redosaurus, attacks and destroys the lighthouse, which is the scene from the Ray Bradbury tale, The Foghorn, that inspired the film so much. Now, it's interesting, when you look back at Ray Harryhausen and Ray Bradbury, the two Rays as teenagers would plan how they were going to work together as adults, how they were going to use Bradbury's literary genius and Ray Harryhausen's animation to create these wonderful tales of dinosaurs and wonderful creatures. Unfortunately, this was their sole collaboration on a major picture, and it came about largely by circumstance. But again, it's great to see that two teenagers would grow up to fulfill their dreams in such a fashion, and this short sequence just exemplifies what wonderful imaginations they had. And so when you listen to this piece, it's very atmospheric, and it reminds you of that evocative animation from Ray. Lots of shadows, lots of darkness, and a very iconic sequence with the lighthouse.
Now, David Buttolph, he also scored over 300 movies in his career. If we think about modern day composers, you know, like Jerry Goldsmith, John Williams and so on, who are very prolific, it's nowhere near 300. I mean, to do 300 films a year, you'd have to be scoring 5 or 6, 7 films, you know, in a 12-month period. Very unusual. It meant very little opportunity for creative growth. It meant very little opportunity to choose your orchestra, work with the director, see what's best musically. So sometimes it can feel, not in this case, but sometimes it can feel like a sledgehammer cracking a nut. And I think it's telling that these early composers who were extremely talented weren't ones that continued to work with the Harryhausen family of filmmakers, with Ray and Charles Schneer and the others. As we move on next to It Came From Beneath the Sea in 1955, how would you best like to pronounce the surname? We'll both have a crack at it. It's Misha Bacon Leichenloff. Is that correct?
No. It's Misha Bakalinikoff. I've written here phonetically to help me with the podcast notes. And he would go on to score all three of the Columbia Ray Harryhausen pictures, starting with It Came From Beneath the Sea. And I think it's very fitting that this is also the time that Charles Schneer came on board and began to work with Ray, and it was a partnership which lasted for many decades and was hugely successful. But with these early films, as we've said, Ray's solo pictures had quite a low budget, and they really had not much time to prepare the films either. So when Misha Bakalinikoff came on board, this was something I think he was a master of. He was a master of putting together soundtracks for films in a very short period of time, and actually reusing material from previous films, from the music library of previous scores.
Absolutely, and it's interesting, as you've noted there, Bakken Leichenloff has become part of that initial family, hasn't he? He's rolled over from one film to the next, so I think his work is had a more contemporary feel for its time. It has a more mid-50s feel. If we look at, you know, scores for Invasion of the Body Snatchers and other similar sci-fi from the time, you know, with the exception of the theremin, you know, this feels very much evocative of the time. And the clip we're going to be playing is The Tentacle and It versus the Golden Gate Bridge. Is that right?
That's right. And there's actually a third: The Tentacle, the It versus the Golden Gate Bridge, and a track called Mr. Monster. Now, the track Mr. Monster has a theme which was reused for all three of the of the Columbia black and white pictures. It was used in 20 Million Miles to Earth and Earth vs. the Flying Saucers as well. So you'll probably recognise it if you've seen those films before. You recognise the piece, very effective, short, four-note theme. And this was quite typical of Bakalynikov's work. But this is, as you say, very of its time, very contemporary for the mid-1950s. I think for somebody who was born after these classic science fiction creature films were created, we get a lot of our information from pop culture, TV shows like The Simpsons, or the Joe Dante film Matinee, about these classic films. And this music, if you played it to anybody and said, where do you think this music comes from? Even if they'd never seen a Ray Harryhausen film before, they would probably rightly guess that it's a science fiction film from the 1950s, or it's a creature feature from the 1950s. And I think this is a perfect atmosphere for the movies that Ray was creating at the time.
We've come to a point where we're going to talk about the technical aspects of the film, because the clips that we've played for you have been beautifully recreated and re-recorded in recent years. Now, they're all available on the Monstrous Movie Music label, mmmrecordings.com, and they've really taken some amazing efforts to painstakingly re-record these with top orchestras around the world. And it's with the Radio Symphony Orchestra of Slovakia. It's interesting how many films do get scored now in Eastern Europe. There's some significant orchestras of very high standard working today. Now, why is it that we're not hearing the original music? Well, to get into some of the technicalities of it, the film would have originally been scored on a scoring stage on magnetic tape, and possibly in stereo more often than not. A mix would have been made down to mono, again onto magnetic tape, and then that would have joined in a mixing studio the film, a final cutting copy of the film, a separate magnetic track for dialogue, a separate magnetic track for sound effects, practical sound effects such as footsteps, separate magnetic track for atmospheres such as inside space, outside space, traffic noise, the weather and so on, and then a myriad of separate tracks for different special effects such as alien voices and laser guns and so on. Now, the idea, all of these separate music magnetic tracks would be mixed down at different sound levels, so the dialogue would always be slightly higher than the music, and the special effects sounds would sometimes be higher than the dialogue for dramatic effect. But it would be honed down, married down onto one single magnetic strip of sound that incorporates all of the sounds that we've just heard singularly that have been loaded up through the tracking system. Now, when that happens, all of those individual tracks are then disposed of. Because it's been mixed down, you've gone through the sound mix process, you have what you need to create the optical sound that is printed on the side of 35mm prints that get sent to cinemas. So all of those original track elements, the separate dialogue, the separate sound and so on, the music, they're all either reused by wiping them magnetically with a magnet, or they're junked. They're simply thrown away for storage purposes. Because of that, the original soundtracks for many motion pictures right up until, well, actually right up until the early 80s, the separate elements for Raise the Titanic, the John Barry film, do not exist for this very purpose. Because of the working practices, if you will, of sound recording and production techniques. So the only way to hear these music sessions separately is to re-record them. So luckily the sheet music still exists. The people working on this have tried to embody the same temperaments and try to use the same instruments, so it sounds very much like the original films, but it's not the original recordings. We will play at the end of this episode some original recordings from Max Steiner so that you can get a different sense of it. If the original recordings did exist, they certainly wouldn't be as good a quality in terms of fidelity, but I think for purists, they do like to hear the original recordings. I've certainly heard recordings with Bernard Herrmann, which are fantastically good in stereo, and you can hear Mr. Herrmann barking his instructions to the orchestra. So that, if you like, explains why films need to be re-recorded. But it didn't spoil your enjoyment, Connor, I guess, listening to them, but you did realise that they were contemporary technical recordings.
No, I think it's clear the a lot of love has been put into these re-recordings, and they're obviously very accurate renditions. If you look into the Monstrous Movie Music back catalogue, I would recommend reading the liner notes of these fantastic soundtracks, because there's a lot of information in them and lots of behind-the-scenes secrets and details about the process behind making these sometimes forgotten about creative people and the soundtracks that they were able to put together. So no, I enjoy listening to these faithful renditions. The original recordings are obviously on the films themselves for you to listen to by comparison, but it's great to have these clear and high fidelity recordings to enjoy. So It Came From the Beneath the Sea was a Misha Bakalynikov score, and one that's very evocative of the era. But we're going to go to something a little different now, and it's a Ray Harryhausen project, which I don't think we've even mentioned on our podcast yet, and it's one that can occasionally get forgotten about. The Animal World, the Irwin Allen film of 1956. John, what are your thoughts on The Animal World? Do you want to tell the listeners a little bit more about this kind of oddity in the canon of Ray Harryhausen movies?
Well, because The Animal World isn't a feature film, it's a sort of a documentary, if you will. It's a David Attenborough-style project, and Ray contributed the dinosaur sequences. And it's, in some way, it's a bit of a curate's egg. You know, people who see it are really fascinated by it. And it's actually finally been made available on Blu-ray. I think it's this year. And it's one that's, you know, purists of Ray Harryhausen will know The Animal World and will know the influence that the film has. But it's by Irwin Allen, who's like one of my favourite film producers. And everyone knows Irwin Allen's work, even if they haven't remembered the name, because he made all those disaster movies in the 70s, such as The Poseidon Adventure and The Time Tunnel and so on. But it includes live action footage of animals, along with the stop motion, which is only a few minutes of dinosaurs. But it is those dinosaurs that feature on the poster. And the intention was to show the progression of life over time and a sort of an evolution. And, you know, it was much more of a scientific film and one that you might find that was played to children in schools. But it wasn't a short film. It was 82 minutes. And it's certainly one that's worth tracking down. Warner Brothers have done a lovely restoration job of it, and it's now available on Blu-ray. The dinosaurs that appear include the Allosaurus, a Stegosaurus, and a pair of Ceratosaurus. A Triceratops and a Tyrannosaurus and a female Brontosaurus, along with one of her hatchlings. So I've done the research, and there are even segments that were included in the Viewmaster slideshow reels as well. So it was one that was reused. We talk about some of the music in Ray Harryhausen's films being library or source music from Columbia Pictures. Well, some of the footage was reused in Night Gallery, and also in the film Trog as well, and the re-release of The Black Scorpion. So it's one of those films that kind of has popped up here and there, but isn't considered wildly to be like one of Ray's great projects, but certainly a bit of a sort of a curate's egg.
So that track was called Survival and the Ceratosaurus. Very much dinosaur music, I think. It's got that lumbering pace. It's got the dramatic sequence for the battle. This music was taking place while a volcano goes off in the background and there's two dinosaurs fighting in the foreground. And just classic piece of dinosaur action. And the animal world was also very interesting because it was the second and final time that Ray got to work with Willis O'Brien. A very short period of time. I think they had 6 weeks or so with Ray doing the animation and Willis O'Brien supervising. But I know that Ray felt that was one of the highlights, really, of his entire career, was getting to work with someone he admired so much. And this, although it was a short project and one that Ray didn't have much control over, it was quite unique and a source of curiosity for years to come afterwards. And I think that the score fits perfectly. And of course, 10 years later, the classic 1 million years BC would bring Ray's dinosaur visions to life in completion, so to speak. There's a very similar battle in that film too.
And it's great to be able to bring composers, you know, back into the mainstream with our podcast. Paul Sawtelle, who was the Polish-born composer for Animal World, you know, his work is to be applauded. And we very much recommend people go to Monstrous Movie Music to find out more, because they do copious insert sleeves as well for all of the soundtracks. So we applaud them and their efforts. What's up next, Connor?
So next up, back to more familiar ground, is the classic main title theme from Earth vs. the Flying Saucers. Now again, this is very evocative of alien attack movies in the 1950s. It fits very well. This was a piece which again was put together from previous movies by Misha Bakalaynikov. He would take pieces from previous films, from this stock of film scores, and then he would tweak them ever so slightly to make them fit the subject at hand. So when listening to this, it really feels like a bespoke piece of science fiction magic, and it sets an ominous tone for the film to come.
It's surprising, you know, it's he's more of a sort of a musical director or musical editor in this case, and it is surprising the amount of work and effort it takes to get to trawl through library to try and find library pieces that will actually fit the picture. I mean, it would have almost been easier to have done a spotting session with a small orchestra, but it was the way in which the studios worked, and it was certainly very effective. And it wasn't something audiences scratched their heads and said, oh, I think I've heard that cue on another film. So the fast turnaround of product, and the lack of, I won't say the lack of gratitude, but the lack of recognition from the studios. You have to remember, this is a time when if you wanted to do a newspaper article or an interview with the star of the day, Clark Gable or Marilyn Monroe, you needed to go through the studio. They would give you the access. You would have to give them questions in advance. They would give you the photographs. So everything was extremely well controlled. And if we just, you know, cross over the other side of town to the Walt Disney Company, people imagined that Walt Disney did all of the drawings and backgrounds and everything when the film came out, because it said Walt Disney Presents. The animators weren't credited significantly, and in some cases at all, on some of the movies. And certainly the background artists and the other technicians didn't really get much of a mention. So the impression one got was that these things just kind of happened by kind of osmosis almost. That's not the case now, because we have the internet and we have independent productions giving, if you like, life and light to every department. But this is at a time when nobody was really known. It was only the stars of the film that would get any kind of recognition. And certainly the producers, the directors, and even Ray Harryhausen at this stage, Connor, wouldn't have any sort of fan base or any sort of recognition at all. And the fact that people can work on 300 films gives a sense of that momentum. If you stop, you'll stop getting the work. And so you can't afford to say no to anything. So it's a case of not saying yes, but just being always available. So, you know, I've heard stories from people from old Hollywood who talk about being very unwell, never having time off, never getting anything close to maternity or paternity leave or booking holidays. It was simply a case of, if you want this job, the job owns you. And, you know, it's not the way we live our lives today. You know, things have drastically changed. And, you know, in many ways for the better, but very keen for all of these composers to get the mention they're getting. And as a Harryhausen buff myself and a trustee of the foundation, I have a lot to say and a lot of knowledge about the later composers, but the earlier composers, not so much. And so I think for both of us, Connor, it's been a bit of an exploration, hasn't it, into this kind of unrecognised world of the film composer editors.
Yes, I think you're right. I think it is a slightly more unknown area of Ray Harryhausen's work, and something that maybe isn't celebrated as much as it should be. I would recommend that anybody who wants to find out a little more about this to watch the extras on the colourised versions of these Columbia films, It Came From Beneath the Sea, Earth vs. the Flying Saucers, and 20 Million Miles to Earth. There's a short documentary from David Schechter about Mika Bakalynikov and the work that he did, and just how this process that John's been describing worked in a little more detail, using the film library and reusing cues from and themes from previous films. And it's a really fascinating area to explore. I can't imagine how a lot of these technicians and a whole lot of these musicians were able to be so prolific and creative at the same time. A very different world, as you say. But speaking of this, we move on to 20 Million Miles to Earth, and we're going to play the music from a very iconic scene in the film. It's a scene where the Emir emerges, hatches from his egg, and emerges from the jelly, rubbing his eyes, looking very vulnerable. And the music here was actually composed for the film. This was something that was specifically composed for this scene, which was relatively rare given that the kind of patchwork nature of the music around, but this is something specifically composed by Bakalynikov, and it's a more subtle and gentle theme. It fits the mood perfectly. There's the electric organ in the background, which just gives it that slightly otherworldly feel, and I think it's a really nice piece. It really reminds you of one of the iconic sequences from that film.
Yes, it really evokes the film, doesn't it? When you hear just the music, it really evokes the film. It is surprising, you know, the list of 18 composers whose music appears in 20 Million Miles to Earth kind of reads like a roll call of the composers of the day. And it is, you know, even Miklos Rocha, Max Steiner, you know, these are cues from work they did on other productions, just all available. I mean, it would never happen now. You'd never be able to get one of today's big composers and just use bits and bobs and sort of dial it into your film. But it's very effective. There's no sense of patchwork. There's no sense of, you know, robbing Peter to pay Paul, or it's, you know, it's kind of a collage of music. In a strange way, there's a house style, I think you can say, that with these Columbia films from the time, it worked really well. And if you were somebody in charge, you would continue this regime, I think. If I, you know, I produce today and I work with composers, and how I work is I will use music that I like and ask a composer to work up something similar. So it gives us a common ground to work within. A very different system in the past, but it's been fascinating hearing all of this music, and almost all of them, I think, have been from the we talked about them before, mmmrecordings.com, the monstrous music people. So definitely worth a look. And for a young person like yourself, Connor, I imagine it's not something you'd normally expect to be listening to through your headphones.
I guess that's part of the appeal, is that it is, you know, slightly obscure now. It's interesting to delve into something that is in danger. You know, it would be in danger of being forgotten about if it wasn't for labels such as Monstrous Movie Music. The fact that they've gone to such exhaustive lengths to preserve this music for future generations, I think, is very important. And we're just going to play one final track from Mighty Joe Young here, which I thought was very interesting to explore. It's the Beautiful Dreamer sequence from the nightclub scene in Mighty Joe Young. Although that wasn't a scene which Ray actually animated, this is one of the rare scenes that was which animated by the second technician, largely, Pete Peterson. When re-recording the music from this film, Monstrous Movie Music invited Ray along to play the cymbals on this track. So what you're going to hear is some of Ray's musical talent as he crashes the cymbals together for this iconic piece of music. And again, this goes to show just how much effort that has been put into these re-recordings. And it's a sequence that most people will have seen the film will remember well, with Joe holding the piano above his head and Terry Moore playing the piano there. Mighty Joe Young is something that we're going to talk a little bit about after playing this track, very evocative of a classic film.
That's wonderful. And as Connor was mentioning, on the sleeve notes to Mighty Joe Young from Monstrous Movie Music, there's actually a picture of Ray crashing the cymbal. So it's fabulous. And now to bring us right up to date, you've got some very exciting news. Who would have thought Mighty Joe Young news? Either we're very late with our news, or it's something new and exciting. What's happening, Connor?
Well, unbelievably, for a film that is nearly 70 years old, there's still artifacts and still fascinating pieces from the film being discovered. So within our own archive, we have over 50 key drawings, storyboards, and other sketches and designs from Mighty Joe Young, as well as countless stills and other documents relating to the film. And it's something that we've been exploring in some depth recently. But aside from our archive, a wonderful piece has been discovered at the University of Aberystwyth in Wales. They've discovered a scrapbook from the film, not a scrapbook, an album from the film, of watercolours, of storyboards, stills, and most interestingly of all, a page which is autographed by the entire cast and crew, as well as doodles from probably Willis O'Brien and Ray Harryhausen themselves. So there's O'Brien, Harryhausen, we've got Robert Armstrong, Terry Moore, all of the stars and crew of the film. And this has been uncovered within the private archive at the University of Aberystwyth. So they are planning on displaying material from this album, and we at the Foundation will be making a very special appearance on the 22nd of November to launch this exhibition. We're going to talk a little bit about Mighty Joe Young and the lost treasures of the Harryhausen Archive.
Well, that's fabulous, and it kind of adds to the roll call of exhibitions and special talks we've done this year. And we, of course, had a big part to play in the Barbicans Into the Unknown exhibition, which now has moved to Greece with the Onassis Foundation. But we do have the Tate Britain exhibition, which is free to see in central London, and we'd urge people to go down and take a look at some of the pieces from the foundation. Pegasus is there, Medusa is there, and a few others, and also some very interesting and rare pieces of art, some which were owned by Ray Harryhausen and some which were in the deep archive of Tate Britain. Now, they've created a special space all for itself, a special gallery space. It's beautiful. I would recommend you get down and have a look. It won't be on forever, but it's a very special place and a very special space. And Connor, you're going to be taking flight to a major exhibition on the other side of the pond.
That's right. I'm headed to Oklahoma to celebrate the Mythical Menagerie exhibition, which is a large exhibition, as you say, and the first exhibition in the United States for many, many years. But I won't be going by myself. On October the 20th, I'll be joined by Ray's daughter, Vanessa Harryhausen, who will be making her first appearance at a special panel and Q&A session. And she'll be talking about some of her memories and her father's work from her unique point of view. Somebody who grew up with Gwangi in her pram, and who grew up watching her dad and being on set of all these classic films. This is a really unique appearance from Vanessa. She's never done anything like this before, and it's very exciting to be hosting this at a screening of Clash of the Titans in Oklahoma.
It is. So we're getting to do a bit of globe trotting. So we're going to finish off this episode now with some audio from Ray Harryhausen himself, and then a lovely piece of music which will be recognisable to fans around the world. It's the original King Kong recording, and it has something very unique at the front of it, of course. It has the RKO radio special effect beeps that it gives. So as the iconic aerial comes up and he goes beep, 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 I think that's pretty impressive. I could replace the beeps there, I think, Connor. Do you think?
Yeah, well, I think what you have to do when you listen to this track is put yourself in the shoes of a 13-year-old boy in 1933. Possibly most of the films you've seen beforehand may have been silent, or at the very least hadn't had quite as an effective soundtrack. And so you just imagine yourself sitting in that dark cinema when this logo pops up and the incredible Max Steiner music kicks in. It was certainly an experience that Ray never forgot. Now, before we go today, we'd like to extend a huge thank you to David Schechter, who's the producer at Monstrous Movie Music. As we've mentioned several times throughout this show, all of the music that you've heard today has come from releases from this fantastic label, and we'd thoroughly recommend that you check them out in more detail. The CDs have fantastic artwork and incredibly in-depth liner notes, and it's a great opportunity to explore an aspect of Ray's career which may have otherwise been a little difficult to find information on. So check out mmmrecordings.com and enjoy delving into the monstrous music.
So here's Ray Harryhausen, and as a reminder, our next special music episode will feature the very great Bernard Herrmann, and we'll be looking at all of the films that Bernard Herrmann worked on with Ray Harryhausen and the one that he didn't. So from Seventh Voyage of Sinbad to First Men in the Moon, please join us for the next episode. And from us, I'd like to say thank you very much. Thank you to Connor. And remember, go to rayharryhausen.com to find out more about us and our social media links. Thank you and goodbye.
I innocently walked one Saturday afternoon into the Grauman's Chinese Cinema to see a film called King Kong. And when I came out, I haven't been the same since. So you can see what an influence a film can be on a young mind. I was 13 at the time, and I'd never seen a film like that before. And I knew it wasn't a man in a suit, particularly the gorilla and the dinosaurs. And the picture was so overwhelming that I felt I had to find out how it was done. We'll be right back.
Copyright in the Ray Harryhausen podcast is owned by the Ray and Diana Harryhausen Foundation, a registered charity, number SC001-419-2017. This recording may not be reproduced in whole or in part without written permission from the Foundation. The views expressed within these podcasts do not necessarily reflect those of the Foundation, its trustees or employees. For further terms and conditions, please contact us at rayharryhausen.com, where you can find our Facebook and Twitter links.